Greetings world. We are Anonymous. We were originally planning to release this particular message if Trump was to become president of the United States, but we later realized that whoever does become president, whether it's Trump, Sanders, or Hillary Clinton, in the end, nothing will stop us, or the citizens of the United States from the inevitable, be it statewide uprisings, mass protests, or revolution. If America ever does have a revolution, be it one of blood, we will survive the even end of spring. We will survive the even end of summer. We will survive the even end of autumn. We will survive the even end of winter. But at what cost? A violent revolution will only destroy the very fabric the Founding Fathers fought and struggled so indefatigable to place. However, if America has a bloodless revolution, not only will it unite the masses, the citizens of other nations will see this as a possible and realistic choice. If the citizens of the United States do decidedly deploy a bloodless revolution, what will stop the citizens from other countries from rising up to their own petty system? By no means is this a call to arms, nor are we declaring war against the United States government. We are only conveying a message to the masses. The citizens of America, like others who have rose up against the system, are tenacious for justice. And as we all know, America's policies affect the globe on a grand stage. But one has to question, what event, decision, or action will the US government take which will alert the masses of the corrupted body that is the US government? Who will lead this revolution? Who will counter it? Will we have a revolution of betrayal and of power struggle like the lost revolutions in the Arab world? Many will not bother to contemplate this and will only find it as naive and ludicrous. Some will go far as to say that revolutions will never exist anymore. Is a revolution in America truly needed right now? The answer lies within you if it does or does not. Until the majority of the masses are not able to strive in becoming what they want to be in life, it is in that moment where they will rise and fight against the system. So it has to be asked, how many more martyrs will there be? How many more voices will have to perish for the US citizenry to notice and care? Until we cease fighting with one another over the non-essential, until we cease our cynic selves, we will never see the light at the end of the tunnel. Until then, however, we are nothing more and nothing less than slaves and animals. Yet we are also not blind. We are fully aware of the mitigating steps the United States government takes to ensure the trust between the people is balanced. There is interaction, but these steps of interaction are too small and too slow. Such a question, however, is too early to state, since our next president is right around the corner. If he or she does not deliver or fulfill the policies they intended to bring, it will be safe to say that the current government is no longer functional. Our economy will further destabilize, our representatives will be hailed as uncooperative, and our system will be destroyed. For over a decade, voting was useless. When it comes to US grounds, corporations and lobbyists are the true leaders of this country and are the ones with the power to control our lives. Nevertheless, to rebuild our government, we must first destroy it. Our time for democracy is here. Our time for real change is here. We call upon the citizens of the United States to stand beside us in overthrowing this corrupted body and call upon a new era. Our allegiance is to those whom fought tirelessly for justice, because they are us, and we are them. This operation will be engaged when the citizens of the United States begin to rise against a government which does not hold its democratic values, against a government that does not listen to its people, against a government which only intends to fulfill its own agenda, against a government whom only functions behind closed doors, and against a government which censors dissidents. We are the common citizen. We will never forgive. We will never forget. To the United States government, and to the empires of the world, we are not terrorists. We are Anonymous. We are not criminals. We are the messengers of the light. Therefore, we declare our right on this earth to be a man, to be a human being, to be respected as a human being, to be given the rights of a human being, in this society, on this earth, in this day, which we intend to bring into existence.
By any means necessary. America today finds herself in a unique situation. Historically, revolutions are bloody. Oh yes, they are. They have never had a bloodless revolution or a non-violent revolution. That don't happen even in Hollywood. You don't have a revolution in which you love your enemy. And you don't have a revolution in which you are begging the system of exploitation to integrate you into it. Revolutions overturn systems. Revolutions destroy systems. A revolution is bloody. But America is in a unique position. She's the only country in history in a position actually to become involved in a bloodless revolution. The Russian Revolution was bloody. Chinese Revolution was bloody. French Revolution was bloody. Cuban Revolution was bloody. And there was nothing more bloody than the American Revolution. But today, this country can become involved in a revolution that won't take bloodshed.
There's a worldwide revolution going on. It goes beyond Mississippi. It goes beyond Alabama. It goes beyond Harlem. What is it revolting against? The power structure. The American power structure? No. The French power structure? No. The English power structure? No. Then what power structure? An international Western power structure.
We are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised.
Americans, mobilize. Stand together, stand tall. Tell the government you're mad as hell. No longer cooperate with the government. Do not accept the national ID card. Do everything in your power to restore freedom and your individuality back to America. Stop being a country run by the institutions for the institutions. Let's go back to we the people, by the people, for the people, as opposed to we the institution, by the institution, for the institution.
Stop being scared. We have to stand up and do what's necessary to take back, to stop these bankers, this elite, this government full of lies, congressmen full of liars.
As Iraq veterans against the war, we are resisting an occupation we once risked our lives for. We swore to support and defend the Constitution of the United States of America, but we found out the hard way that the greatest enemies of the Constitution are not to be found in the sands of some far-off land, but rather right here at home! When injustice becomes law, resistance becomes duty. It is time we start meeting oppression with resistance. They cannot stop us! Humanity marches on. The utmost manifestation of love and devotion to America is today, as it always has been, resistance of tyranny. Resist we must, and resist we will. We will not be silent. We will not obey. We will not let our government destroy our humanity. We will not wait another moment in fear to stand up for what we know to be right. It is time we start meeting oppression with resistance.
Northwoods, explain that really quick.
This is 1962, the Joint Chiefs of Staff signed a document that was planning on having fake attacks on American civilians and blaming it on the Cubans to get us to go to war with Cuba.
Oh,
they were
going
to blow up a drone jetliner. They're going to send a jet into the air and blow it up.
Oh, my God.
And blame the Cubans for it and get us to go to war with Cuba. Planning on having fake attacks on American civilians.
The time when the operation of the machine becomes so odious, makes you so sick at heart, that you can't take part. You can't even passively take part. And you've got to put your bodies upon the gears and upon the wheels, upon the levers, by all the apparatus, and you've got to make it stop. And you've got to indicate to the people who run it, to the people who own it, that unless you're free, the machine will be prevented from working at all.
I served with Kilo Company, 3rd Battalion, 8th Marines, as an automatic machine gunner. There's a term, once a Marine, always a Marine. But there's also the term, eat the apple, F the core. I don't work for you no more.
And I'm a Marine. I took an oath to defend the Constitution. The Constitution! I didn't take an oath to defend these banksters. And I guarantee you, all you devil dogs out there need to rise up and take over this country and defend the Constitution against these bones. Okay, I'm sick of it too, Alex. You know, I'm a Marine, but I'm sick of this. You know, they're using us and they're sucking us dry and they are destroying us.
People should not be afraid of their governments. Governments should be afraid of their people.
Councils of government, we must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex. The potential for the disastrous rise of misplaced power exists and will persist. We must never let the weight of this combination endanger our liberties or democratic processes.